Questions orales, oral questions, the Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, it is a very good day for the voters in Chicoutimi-le-Fjord. Richard Martel was elected and took his seat today. Unfortunately, we need to talk about the trip of the Prime Minister to India, which led to a diplomatic crisis where a terrorist was invited to attend. And the Prime Minister's negotiations did not lead to much economically when it comes to investment in Canada. The trip cost at least $1.5 billion. Why? The Right Honourable Prime Minister. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I wish to congratulate Richard Martel for his victory in Chicoutimi-le-Fjord. And I would like to thank all of the candidates who participated in the election, as well as all the voters. It's important to get people involved, and we're very proud of it. I would like to take the opportunity, because this is our last day, to thank the pages who have served us so well in the House of Commons for so long.
Been here working hard for us. Thank you for everything you've done throughout this year. Thank you all to all the staff for seeing us off through this summer. Merci.
Honourable Leader of the Opposition, Mr. Speaker, the Prime Minister cannot manage taxpayers' money's responsibility. $8 million for a temporary skating rink, $215,000 for an illegal vacation, a disastrous trip in India that cost over $1 billion, and non-essential items were purchased for the Harrington Lake cottage. Why does the Prime Minister keep spending recklessly and keep sending the bill to the next generation, the Right Honourable Prime Minister? Mr. Speaker, we promised to Canadians that we would invest in the middle class and all those working hard to join it. That is exactly what we have done with historic investments in infrastructure, with the Canada Child Benefit, which has helped 9 out of 10 Canadian families and will help 300,000 youth climb out of poverty. We've lowered taxes for the middle class and increased them for the wealthiest. Mr. Speaker, not only are we investing in Canadians who need it, but we've demonstrated the highest rate of growth in the G7 last year. We are generating the growth that Canadians need. The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, he says he's investing in the middle class. Well, since when does the Prime Minister's family count as the middle class? Instead of planning for Canada's economy against the external threats that face us, where are his priorities? Where are his investments? Well, $8,500 for new boat racks, $13,000 for a new deck with sun umbrellas, and $7,500 for a new play structure. Now, I've bought many swing sets and play structures for my kids. Can the Prime Minister tell me what exactly is part of a $7,500 swing set?
Right, Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, you got elected on a commitment to invest in the middle class and those working hard to join it, and that's exactly what we've done. First thing we did was lower taxes for the middle class and raise them on the wealthiest 1%, which the Conservatives voted against. Then we delivered on a Canada Child Benefit that helps 9 out of 10 Canadian families by not sending child benefit checks to millionaires and is lifting hundreds of thousands of kids out of poverty across the country, and the Conservatives voted against it. Mr. Speaker, the Conservatives continue to look for boutique tax cuts for the wealthiest Canadians, while we are supporting middle-class Canadians right across the country, and we will continue to do just that.
Hello. Order. The Honourable Leader of the Opposition has the floor.
Mr. Speaker, the Prime Minister is writing checks from taxpayers' accounts to his own family to reimburse for personal costs. It doesn't end there. $28,000 to groom his cross-country ski trails, $5,000 for a new golf cart, and more than $4,000 to wire up his new sauna. But I have to come back to the swing sets. I've bought several for my family. I'm trying to imagine what goes into a $7,500 swing set. Can the Prime Minister tell me, is there a chairlift for the slide? Are the seats on the swing ergonomically designed? And will he finally reimburse taxpayers for that?
Right, Honourable Prime Minister.
National Capital Commission is responsible for ensuring the appropriate and timely maintenance for all official residences, including Stornoway. The NCC is conducting much-needed rehabilitation work at Harrington Lake in order to conserve this federally designated heritage building. The RCMP will also be conducting work to enhance the security features at Harrington Lake, and the NCC is working to address these issues in a timely fashion.
The Honourable Order. The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, I just want to know from the Prime Minister, if he will allow me, I will be seeking unanimous consent after question period to table the following document. It is entitled, quote, Sports Power 8 Station Swing Set. It has a wonderful slide, it has a seesaw, it has several swings, and it only costs $198. Will he allow me to table this after question period?
Right Honourable Prime Minister.
We are in a tariff conflict with the United States. We are seeing horrific images of children being detained across the United States. We are seeing Indigenous peoples in this country challenged and meeting better opportunities. We're seeing a broad range of issues that matter on this, the last day of sitting of the House of Commons. We moved forward on the legalization of marijuana, which I know is an issue that they have issues with. But this is what the leader of the official opposition chooses to spend his last day in Parliament for the summer.
Opposition House Leader and others that the time to make their arguments is when they have the floor and not when someone else has the floor. That's correct. Honorable député de Rimouski Neigette de Mascouata-les-Basses.
Mr. Speaker, 2 days after accusing the NDP of playing politics by protesting the situation of separating migrant children and parents at the border between Mexico and the United States, the Prime Minister now recognizes that the situation is unacceptable. Now that he has condemned the situation, can he tell us if he still believes that the United States is a safe country for asylum seekers? The Right Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, Canadians throughout the country are deeply concerned by the images that we have seen. As I've said, what is happening is unacceptable. I can't imagine the pain that these families are experiencing. However, the Safe Third Countries Agreement is over 10 years old, and we're looking for ways to update it. We are holding constant conversations with the United States, and we continue to closely monitor the developments there. The Honourable Member for Rimouski Neigette de Mascouata-les-Basses. You can't have your cake and eat it too. We've signed a treaty where asylum seekers will have a fair, humane, decent treatment in both countries. The situation in the United States where children are being separated from their migrant parents is what's happening. Beyond the statements he can read, is he ready to denounce what's happening in the United States? Is he ready to say that it's unacceptable? Can he say that this treatment means that the United States is no longer a safe third country? The Right Honourable Prime Minister. As I said, the situation is unacceptable, and we are closely monitoring what's happening in the United States. We will continue to work with the Americans on protecting our borders, on the agreements that we have with them, while protecting and ensuring and expressing our values about how we do things in Canada. We don't do things the same way, evidently.
East.
The fact is over 2,000 migrant children are already in baby jails. The parents don't know where they are or when they will see them again. The head of the U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement confirmed parents' worst fears. He expects hundreds of separated children will never see their parents again. They will be lost in the system forever. So does the Prime Minister recognize that as long as Trump is in power, the U.S. will never be a safe country for asylum seekers?
The Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, as I've said, what's happening is wrong. None of us can imagine what these families are going through, and I know all Canadians have the well-being of children first and foremost in their minds. And as I've said numerous times, both at home and abroad, I will always stand up for the values that Canadians hold dear. This is something that I will continue to do.
The member for Vancouver East.
But Trump has closed the doors to those fleeing gang violence and domestic violence. Yet many fleeing from Central America cite gang violence as the main reason to seek asylum. Trump's policy is in violation of the UN Convention for Gender-Related Persecution. As long as Trump is in power, the U.S. will never be a safe country for asylum seekers. Will the Prime Minister show the moral leadership by suspending the Safe Third Country Agreement?
Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, Canadians across the country are very concerned with the stories and images that we have witnessed. As I've said, what is happening in the United States is wrong. I cannot imagine what these families are going through. As I've said many times, the Safe Third Country Agreement is over 10 years old, and we will continually look for ways to modernize it and be in conversation with the Americans on this. And we will continue as well to closely monitor developments in the United States.
Mr. Speaker, we're starting to see the travel costs of the Prime Minister's catastrophic trip to India, $17,000 for a Canadian chef who prepared a single meal, $60,000 to rent vehicles with drivers, and hundreds of thousands of dollars spent to accommodate the 77 members of the delegation, including 20 MPs who did not have a single work meeting during the trip. We're already at $1.5 million. And we're not done adding it all up. How can the Prime Minister justify such extravagant expenses to the Canadian public?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, it's important for the Canadians to be effective on the world stage. During our trip to India, we announced bilateral investments of over $1 billion, which will contribute to generating 5,800 jobs in Canada, $11.5 million for the Good Start Initiative, to favor the education of the poorest women and girls. This supports the middle class and those who work hard to join it. But this trip of 9 days cost a lot less than the 6-day trip that Stephen Harper took to India years ago.
The Honourable Member for Richmond Arthabaska. The problem with these irresponsible expenditures by the Prime Minister is that they're paid for by Canadians' money and they are recurring. Here's the new costs of the Prime Minister's cottage, $3,000 for parasols, $7,500 for swing sets, $12,000 to replace a floating dock, $5,000 for golf carts, and 80% of Canadian families are paying more taxes and income tax under this government. How can the Prime Minister justify such expenses while spending hard-earned taxpayers' money?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister. The Conservatives may not remember why the Prime Minister's trip to India was so expensive. It's because he wanted to bring his limousines with him. It cost $1.5 million. That's the Conservative approach. And when it comes to the National Capital Commission, they ensure regular maintenance of all official residences. The National Capital Commission has been conducting renovations that were necessary to preserve buildings designated as part of federal heritage. The Honourable Member for Milton.
The indignation with which the Prime Minister emotes is very troubling when it comes to him discussing his expenses on the India trip. Primarily, the Prime Minister is not above scrutiny when it comes to expenses that he incurs, and in fact, he signs off on these. For the India trip alone, they flew in $5,000 worth of wine, they charged $5,000 on cell phone costs, and they had $60,000 in personal chauffeurs. Did the Prime Minister sign off on all of these expenses?
The Honourable Prime Minister.
The Conservative government spent over $1.5 million bringing Stephen Harper's limos from Ottawa to India for his trip, because he wanted to travel around in the style to which he was accustomed. Well, Mr. Speaker, that is completely irresponsible. We were proud that our trip to India, which cost 9 days and secured $1 billion worth of bilateral investment, cost significantly less than his 6-day trip.
The Honourable Member for Milton.
Once again, Mr. Speaker, we are confronted with anger from this Prime Minister that we have the audacity to ask questions about his spending habits. You know what they say in private sector? Tone is set at the top. And you know what the tone of this government is? A culture of spending and excess. That's all that this is. So, Mr. Speaker, maybe he can tell me why at his personal retreat in Harrington Lake he thinks it's okay to spend $10,000 for a new patio, $12,000 for deck and dock upgrades, and $60,000 in total on these upgrades when Canadians are worried about paying for his carbon tax.
Right, Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I wouldn't want to make an error in the House of Commons. I need to point out the armoured limos only cost $1 million to bring to India. I'm sorry I got the number wrong previously. Mr. Speaker, we remain focused on investing and growing the economy and supporting Canadians. That's why we lowered taxes on the middle class and raised them on the wealthiest 1%. The Conservatives voted against that. That's why we're delivering a Canada Child benefit that delivers more money to 9 out of 10 Canadian families and is lifting hundreds of thousands of kids out of poverty. And again, the Conservatives voted against
it. I ask the Honourable Member for Edmonton Manning and others not to be speaking when someone else has the floor. The idea is that each side gets to make its arguments. Often the other side doesn't like those arguments, but each side gets to make them. And we need to listen and hear the other side, whether we like it or not. The Honourable House Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, it's becoming increasingly clear that the Prime Minister is out of touch with the struggles of everyday Canadians. He's using his job to pay for his celebrity lifestyle. The Prime Minister thinks that he's entitled to his entitlements. He spares no expense when he wants to be pampered and showered with luxury. Who would have guessed that he could have used $1.5 million for 6 days to dance around India? Unbelievable, Mr. Speaker. When will he stop using taxpayers' dollars as his own personal bank account? Because it isn't.
Honourable Prime Minister.
Speaker, we were pleased to secure over $1 billion in two-way investment between India and Canada. We were pleased to secure at least 5,800 new jobs in investment in Canada from that trip. We were pleased to do a lot of good work on that 9-day trip for less than it cost Stephen Harper and the Conservatives to do a 6-day trip just a few years before. Mr. Speaker, we stay focused on the things that matter to Canadians, on growing the economy in ways that are far greater than the Conservatives were able to do for 10 years.
Honourable Opposition House Leader.
Well, Mr. Speaker, in regards to the India trip, I don't recall Prime Minister Harper bringing his own personal chef. What was that, $17,000? And may I add a terrorist along on the trip?
Yeah, that's right.
Maybe the Prime Minister needs to park the arrogance and swagger for just a split second. We know summer's around the corner. We know what that means. The Prime Minister is going to be taking quite a bit of time off. So if he could just, at this moment, have a little bit of humility, tell Canadians he's sorry for abusing their tax dollar, and he won't do it again.
Yeah. Right, Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, the member opposite highlighted that indeed our summer's around the corner. We'll be spending them across the country, engaging with Canadians, as will every member of this House. Hopefully there will be a little time for families for many of us as well, but we know we will continue, all of us in this House, to stay focused on the responsibilities we will for Canadians. Which is interesting that on this last day in the House, when plenty of big things are happening around the world, the Conservatives are making the choice to play petty politics and make personal attacks when they're there are so many big issues we can and should be talking about. I encourage them to.
The L'honorable député de Rosemont, la petite patrie.
Monsieur le Président, est-ce qu'on trouve ça normal?
Mr. Speaker, is it normal for people to be killed because they participate in a protest? When people exercise their right to peaceful protest, is it possible that they might be fired upon? That's the opinion of the former head of the Bank of Canada, David Dodge. Protests are coming. Thousands of people are furious about the Liberal government's decision to buy the Kinder Morgan pipeline. They are going to express themselves, and they have the right. Can the Prime Minister reassure this House that he will not use infiltration, intimidation, or excessive force against our own citizens? The Right Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, it is extremely important for us, for Canadians to have freedom of expression and to be able to disagree with the government and the decisions made in Canada. That is an important right, and we support it. Evidently, we're all expecting that these protests and expressions obey the law, and they do not endanger other citizens. We understand that this is a state where the rule of law prevails, and we expect laws to be upheld.
You know, many Canadians are asking themselves, whatever happened to that shiny, progressive, climate-fighting Prime Minister? You know, the guy who once said, no relationship is more important to me than the relationship with Indigenous people? Or that governments grant permits, but only communities grant permission? Or this classic when he said, we have a chance to build an economy that is clean, growing, and forward-looking. Then he went out and bought a $4.5 billion, 65-year-old leaky pipeline. So a question for the Prime Minister. For all those people that thought he was progressive, thought he believed in the new economy, and thought he was going to fight climate change, whatever happened to that guy?
Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, this government is investing $8 billion in clean technology and renewable energy. That is where we are focused on moving forward. But we're also moving forward with a pan-Canadian approach to fight climate change, one that understands that growing the economy and protecting the environment need to go together. Unfortunately, the NDP do not get that, still think there's a choice to be made between the environment and the economy. And when it comes to Indigenous peoples, only listen to those who agree with them and have nothing to say about the Indigenous communities that support energy projects.
Honourable Member for Oshawa.
Mr. Speaker, yesterday the Parliamentary Secretary to the Minister of Justice dismissed the concerns of Canadian auto workers, saying everything was just fine. Well, it's not fine, Mr. Speaker, when TD Bank says 160,000 jobs are at risk. The Minister of Foreign Affairs is unable to provide details on her plan to protect the jobs of workers in the auto industry. So I'm just going to ask again a simple question to the Prime Minister. What is the plan to protect auto manufacturing jobs in Canada?
Yeah. Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, we have consistently stood up for Canadian interests and Canadian jobs, and we will continue to. We are standing up strongly against these unfair steel and aluminum tariffs that are challenging for our industry and our workers, and I've said to workers directly right across the country that we will be there for them. The threat of tariffs that could be imposed on auto would be absolutely unacceptable. We continue to work with the industry in Canada and in the United States to ensure that that never happens. We know that we need to continue to stand up for Canadians, and we will do just that.
The Honourable Member for Edmonton Riverbend.
This government super clusters program is set to hand over $950 million of Canadian taxpayer money to for-profit companies. Of the many applications received, 9 were shortlisted, and then 5 were selected to receive the funds, shutting out agri-food, oil and gas, infrastructure, mobility systems, and mining applications. Wow. How does this Prime Minister justify picking winners and losers, leaving Canadian taxpayers on the hook for his corporate welfare scheme?
Honourable Prime Minister.
To repeat the announcement that amongst our superclusters strategy, we're moving forward with the protein supercluster, which benefits prairie ridings, prairie communities right across the prairies that will definitely benefit from the kinds of investments, the kind of innovation, the kind of leadership that investment in agriculture needs to happen. We are proud to be supporting our farmers and our agri-food businesses. The Conservatives talk a good game, but we're never there for them when it came to actually creating growth.
Thank you. Honourable Member for Foothills.
Well, I'll tell you about the Liberals' support for agriculture, Mr. Speaker. According to the numbers from the Parliamentary Budget Officer, the Liberals' carbon tax will devastate Canadian agriculture. At $50 a ton, the Liberal carbon tax will cost a Manitoba pork producer more than $36,000 a year.
Shameful.
A rancher in Alberta, $13,000. A wheat grower in Saskatchewan, $12,000. If you're a potato farmer in PEI, the agriculture minister thinks you should be paying $20,000 a year in carbon tax.
Wow.
Does the Prime Minister agree with these numbers? If not, will he end the cover-up and release the cost of the Liberals' farm-killing carbon tax?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
See, Mr. Speaker, the Conservatives spend all their time trying to twist in the wind because they do not admit that climate change is a problem, do not have a plan to fight climate change, and therefore can't reveal the details of their plan. We've been transparent in the election campaign ever since, in the last budget. We have demonstrated that we're moving forward on growing our economy and protecting the environment at the same time, moving forward on a concrete plan with all provinces to fight climate change. That's what we are doing. The Conservatives can't say what they're doing because they don't know what they're doing because they don't have a plan.
Honorable député, alors, de Mégantic, l'erreur.
Monsieur le Président, votre le secret continue.
Mr. Speaker, we see that the secret continues. The attacks on dairy farmers aren't all coming from the United States. The Liberal Party is the one who will force dairy farmers to pay their carbon tax. That's $17,000 for a medium-sized farm in Quebec. In BC, $28,000. Unfortunately for dairy farmers in the Maritimes, the Minister of Agriculture hasn't forgotten you. It'll go up to $21,000 in New Brunswick and Nova Scotia, $18,000 in PEI. And brace yourself! $39,000 in Newfoundland. Why does the Prime Minister remain silent in the face of these attacks which threaten the survival of our family farms throughout Canada? The Right Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, the Conservatives are inventing numbers to distract everyone from the fact that they have no intention of tackling climate change. They can't say what their plan is to tackle climate change because they do not have one. All of their attacks are done in the hope that no one will notice that they have no plan at all, and they are more or less interested in fighting climate change. The Conservatives haven't changed for 10 years after 10 years of inaction.
Ms. Nippy, Churchill River.
Yesterday, I asked the Liberals if they would support my private member's bill to make National Indigenous Peoples Day a statutory holiday. Instead of saying if they would support it, the minister spoke about the government celebrations taking place. But people already know about the celebrations. What they want is for the Liberals to actually recognize the importance of providing people with a time and opportunity to celebrate. So I'm asking again, will the Liberals support my bill and make National Indigenous Peoples Day a statutory holiday?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, no relationship is more important to us than the relationship with Indigenous peoples, and that's why when we talk about moving forward on issues like this, we need to make sure that it's not folks in Ottawa deciding what's going to happen. It needs to be in consultation and in partnership with Indigenous peoples. That's why we are looking very closely at the calls to action, where we're looking very closely at relationships with Indigenous communities to figure out the best way to move forward on commemorating reconciliation. We look forward to having more to say soon on this issue.
Honourable Member for Churchill, Kiwetinuk, Askew.
Mr. Speaker, so many Indigenous people are asking for this day to be a statutory holiday, and the Prime Minister is clearly not listening. Et voyons, le gouvernement.
The government continues to prove that it doesn't really respect First Nations or the UN Declaration that it adopted. It doesn't listen to Indigenous communities, as its botched consultations on pipeline projects show. Will the government at least support my colleague's bill that would allow all Canadians to celebrate along with Indigenous peoples and learn more about their rights and culture? Right Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, I'm very proud that every year we gather to recognize the fundamental contributions that First Nations, Métis and Inuit have made to the culture of all Canadians. We are working with Indigenous peoples to establish a nation-to-nation relationship between the Inuit and the Crown, and a government-to-government relationship based on respect, partnership, and the recognition of rights. We will continue to work with our partners on shared priorities, including this celebration.
Honourable Member for Kenora.
Mr. Speaker, our government is proposing measures that represent a reasonable and common sense approach to firearm policy to make Canadians less vulnerable to gun violence. First, Mr. Speaker, I want to be clear that this bill does not recreate a federal long gun registry. As parliamentarians, I strongly believe that we have no greater responsibility than keeping Canadians safe. Can the Prime Minister explain how enhanced background checks make society, gun owners and Canadians safer and more secure?
Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I thank the member for Kenora for his question. We are strengthening Canada's firearm laws in a common sense, focused and effective way. We are enhancing background checks, which the committee have further strengthened, so people with histories of criminality or mental illness associated with violence cannot access firearms. We are formalizing best practices amongst retailers so that they make sure buyers have a valid license. We're also investing unprecedented funding of $327 million to tackle gun-related violence and gang activities in Canada. We are prioritizing community safety while respecting responsible firearm owners.
The
Honourable Member for Charlebourg-Haute-Saint-Charles. Mr. Speaker, the Prime Minister has no respect for the provinces. His government tabled a bill to legalize marijuana and is ordering the provinces to execute it. When the provinces accept the challenge and try to find a plan that works for their citizens, the Prime Minister stubbornly continues to impose his terms. During the 2015 election campaign, he had promised partnership with the provinces. Well, here's a golden opportunity for the Prime Minister. Will he respect the decisions of Quebec and Manitoba to ban home cultivation of marijuana? Yes or no? Right Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, we are committed to improving our system to better protect our youth and to take money away from organized crime. That's exactly what we did, and we did it in partnership with the provinces. We always work in partnership with the provinces. And since we passed these measures in Parliament, and since we decided to move forward, we've been listening to the provinces who are asking for more time to implement it. That's why we are accepting the request of the provinces, and we will be legalizing it as of October 17th, 2018. The Honourable Member for Charlebourg-Haute-Saint-Charles. Mr. Speaker, the Prime Minister always has a lot of nice speeches with lovely promises, but we need to see concrete action. Quebec has already made its law and has said that it won't have home cultivation in condos and houses. Will the Prime Minister listen to Quebec? Or is he ready to go to court? Will he listen to Quebec, yes or no? Right Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, we are proud to have passed our bill to legalize marijuana and to strictly regulate its access. This measure will help keep marijuana out of the hands of youth and out of and the profits out of the hands of organized crime. But I'll just give a very specific answer to the member across the way. And I will repeat it so that he understands. I recently announced that on October 17th, the bill will come into force. And we chose that because three big provinces, including Quebec, asked us for a little bit more time. I know that it's important to do things properly, and so we are giving Quebec more time.
Member for Selkirk, Interlake, Eastman.
Mr. Speaker, Nada is a young Yazidi mother from Iraq. When ISIS invaded her community, she was sold as a sex slave. She recently recounted coming face to face with Abu Tafiq, the man she says sold her and bought her. He wasn't in jail. He wasn't in Iraq. He's a free man in London, Ontario. We need to believe victims, and the Liberals let this guy into our country. Will the Prime Minister take responsibility for allowing ISIS terrorists to walk our streets freely and finally send these war criminals to The Hague?
Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Speaker, in regards to the Yazidis, our government has proven to be a global leader in welcoming refugees, and we've more than doubled Canada's refugee numbers. We've provided a new home to more than 1,300 women and their families who endured the brutality of Daesh, 85% of whom are Yazidi. Our government's commitment to supporting vulnerable women and girls is unwavering. We announced $20 million to expand our refugee program, specifically targeting women and girls. We will continue to expedite applications so that their family members who escaped Daesh can join their relatives in Canada.
The Honourable Member for Calgary Nose Hill.
After sitting with a Yazidi woman who survived sexual slavery, you leave awed by her strength, concerned for her welfare, and left with a deep, white-hot desire to bring her justice. When we wax eloquent about Me Too, we cannot forget our obligation to bring justice to women who have had their bodies used as tools of war. Why does this feminist Prime Minister continually refuse to commit to refer Canadian ISIS terrorists to the International Criminal Court?
Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, our security agencies take all potential threats very seriously and use the full toolkit of measures, including surveillance, the no-fly lists, revoking passports, and laying criminal charges when sufficient evidence exists. We trust our police forces and intelligence services to do their work and to do it well. I find it actually troubling that the Conservatives seem to want elected officials to directly intervene with police officers and tell them who should be arrested and when they should be arrested. We will continue to trust those responsible for the safety of Canadians to do their jobs.
Right. Honourable Member. Order. The Honourable Member for Windsor-Tecumseh.
Mr. Speaker, Canada ratified the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities 8 long years ago, but to this day we failed to implement it. That's why Canadians are watching as the Minister tables this government's long-awaited Accessibility Act this afternoon. People living with disabilities need more than a vague promise for a barrier-free Canada. So can the Prime Minister tell us, will today's legislation fulfill Canada's obligations to the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities?
Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, our government is committed to ensuring the full participation of people with disabilities in society, and we've taken steps to do so. We support a variety of programs and services to assist those with disabilities to gain employment, to develop skills, and to gain experience. For 10 long years, the Harper Conservatives promised to deliver legislation for persons with disabilities, but did nothing. And I'm not going to break with parliamentary privilege, Mr. Speaker, but I will confirm that, in fact, we will be introducing this historic accessibility legislation before the House rises for the summer.
Order.
The Honourable Member for Salaberry-sur-Oise. Mr. Speaker, the number of people affected by Lyme disease doubled in Quebec in 2017, and it's continued to steadily increase every year due to climate change. The government established a federal framework on Lyme disease last year, but the guidelines still haven't been implemented. If left untreated, this disease can lead to cardiac and neurological problems, and we know that it's often misdiagnosed or not identified. So when will victims of Lyme disease have access to better diagnostic testing and treatments for chronic cases? Right, Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, I thank the Honourable Member for her question. This is an issue that affects far too many Canadians, and I know that it's very difficult to live with Lyme disease. We recognize that there's still a lot of research to be done, but we are committed to working with Lyme disease victims and researchers to help protect all Canadians. This is a very important issue, and I'd like to thank the member once again for having raised it in the House.
Member for Cypress Hills Grasslands.
Mr. Speaker, the Iranian regime continues to brutalize its own citizens. Mohammed Salas, a bus driver, member of a religious minority, was arrested. He was then tortured. His phony confession was then broadcast on state television. It was used as the only evidence in his trial. On Monday at dawn, he was executed, and then the regime refused to allow his family to even see the body. When will this Liberal government start to support the Iranian people and stop fantasizing about normalizing relations with this vicious, murderous, terrorist regime?
Right, Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, we deeply oppose Iran's support for terrorist organizations, its threats towards Israel, its ballistic missile program, and its support for the murderous Assad regime. We will always defend human rights and hold Iran to account for its actions. We led a resolution at the United Nations in November calling on Iran to comply with its international human rights obligations. We will continue to maintain sanctions on Iran, which include restrictions on sensitive goods and a list of individuals and entities subject to asset freezes with whom all transactions involving property are prohibited.
Honourable Member for Sherwood Park, Fort Saskatchewan.
Mr. Speaker, yesterday the Foreign Affairs Minister finally acknowledged genocide of Yazidis at the hands of Daesh in Syria and Iraq. But the government has yet to acknowledge genocide against Christian communities in the same areas. Assyrian, Chaldean, and other Christians who live in communities alongside Yazidis and have often been treated in exactly the same way. So will the Prime Minister today also acknowledge the Christian victims of this genocide?
Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, our government stands strong in the fight against Daesh and will continue to be part of the coalition as we defend minorities of all types from the murderous terrorist organizations of Daesh and the like. We continue to support victims of Daesh from all different cultures and religions. We've looked at resettling numerous minority refugees who are victims of Daesh. We will continue to hold our place in the world in defending victims and minorities against the murderous actions of Daesh.
Member for Durham.
Mr. Speaker, the Prime Minister just mentioned holding Iran to account. Well, last night the MP for Richmond Hill organized an event on the Hill for a regime-friendly Iranian lobbying group. Last week, this same group publicly criticized the House of Commons for passing a motion condemning Iran.
What?
The Iranian regime is an oppressive abuser of human rights. Does the Prime Minister approve of the actions of the MP for Richmond Hill organizing parliamentary meetings for a group that supports the Iranian regime?
Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, as politicians, we engage with a broad range of people, but we have been unequivocal. We deeply oppose Iran's support for terrorist organizations, for its threats towards Israel, towards its ballistic missile program, and its support for the murderous Assad regime. We will always defend human rights and hold Iran to account for its actions. We continue to maintain sanctions on Iran, which include restrictions on sensitive goods and a list of individuals and entities subject to asset freezes. We will always remain firm in our defense of human rights and our standing against state sponsors of terrorism around the world.
A member for Kitchener Centre.
Monsieur le Président, nous avons...
Mr. Speaker, we've all seen the troubling statistics. In 2016, over a million Canadians had to choose between feeding their families, heating their homes, and having their prescriptions filled. I've heard similar complaints in my riding of Kitchener Centre.
We proudly announced the creation of an advisory council on the implementation of national pharmacare. Can the Prime Minister please update this House on the progress that our government has made in this area? Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Right Honourable Prime Minister.
I thank the member for Kitchener Centre for his work on this issue and his excellent French. Canadians can be proud of our public health care system. But there's always room for improvement. That's why we created an advisory council for the implementation of the National Pharmacare Program, which will study, evaluate, and make recommendations about medication insurance. We have many accomplished members who will be sitting on the board, and we are looking forward to their report so that we can improve our system for Canadians.
For Lakeland.
Mr. Speaker, in 2 months, the Prime Minister will close the high-performing Vegreville Immigration Office, killing 280 jobs, dozens more in town, and millions in local revenue. It won't even save tax dollars. It'll cost nearly $47 million more for renos and leasing for only 32 extra jobs in Edmonton. The Prime Minister ignores the pleas of workers, the union, the town, and Alberta representatives of all parties at all levels. He's hurting the 74% of women supporting their families and the disabled workers with long-term placements in the office. Will the Prime Minister please stop this unfounded, cold-hearted closure?
Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, over the past 2 years, Canadians across the country have been thanking us for reinvesting in immigration services and processing times. After 10 years of conservatives shutting down, creating backlogs, starving our immigration systems from being able to actually process the backlogs and the resources they need, giving them the resources they needed. We know that we need to do better on processing times. We need to invest in our immigration system. That's exactly why we are ensuring that we have the capacity in our system to treat the files that Canadians and new Canadians expect us to treat rapidly and efficiently.
Honourable member for... I'd ask the honourable member for Lakeland to stop interrupting. No, Honourable Member for Port Moody, Coquitlam.
Recently, a Liberal MP said the time has come to transition closed containment salmon aquaculture in British Columbia. Mr. Speaker, I couldn't agree more. Canada is well positioned to become a world leader in closed containment, but we need action now. Globally, money is being invested in land-based salmon farming. In Florida, for instance, they're building a 90,000-ton facility. It's time for Canada to invest in a safe, sustainable industry that protects wild salmon and employment, develops new technologies, jobs, and export opportunities. Will the Prime Minister commit today to transition these farms to land?
I have to also ask a member for Grand Prairie Mackenzie not to be talking when someone else has the floor. The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, we have tasked the Federal Science Advisor to actually look into the question of aquaculture so we can make evidence-based policy moves going forward. But I would highlight to my colleague from the NDP that he should have a conversation with his provincial counterparts if he's not fighting with them as they are with their provincial counterparts in Alberta, because they just approved continued tenure for aquaculture farms that is their decision on the provincial side, and we know there are significant concerns that we're moving forward.
Honourable Member for Kildonan, St. Paul.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Severe weather events are a significant and growing problem across Canada. In my province of Manitoba, we've seen firsthand the devastating effects of flooding can have on our communities. These floods have forced residents from homes, businesses to relocate or close, and caused residents to worry annually that the year's flood season may bring. Can the Prime Minister please update this House on the steps that our government is taking to improve the resiliency of Canadian communities, especially those in Manitoba?
Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the member for Kildonan St. Paul for her hard work in her community and her question. Our government knows that climate change is real and that the frequency of severe weather events like flooding is increasing. That's why this week we were proud to announce a federal investment of almost $250 million in the Lake Manitoba and Lake St. Martin outlet channels. Alongside the province, our investment will allow for the management of the flows of these watersheds and protect the communities of the region for years to come.
Honourable Member for Flamborough-Glanbrook.
Mr. Speaker, troubling reports are surfacing that the Minister of Immigration is planning on removing Her Majesty from the oath of citizenship. Can the Prime Minister confirm if his government is discussing removing Her Majesty from the oath of citizenship?
Are you kidding?
Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I can confirm that we are not considering removing Her Majesty from the oath of citizenship.
The Honourable Member for Regina Louvain.
Mr. Speaker, the federal government has repeatedly stated that provinces will keep the revenues from carbon pricing. But next year is a renewal of equalization. If carbon revenues are added to the formula, then each province's carbon tax base would count against its equalization entitlement, effectively clawing back the money. Will the government include carbon pricing and equalization? And if so, how will it ensure that provinces actually keep the revenues?
Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, we know that both the Conservatives and the NDP think there is a false choice between either the environment or the economy. Apparently the CCF does as well. We know that the only way to move forward is to invest in protecting our environment while growing our economy. That's exactly what we're doing with our national framework on fighting climate change. We are proud that we've been transparent about the way we're moving forward on that. We've been clear with Canadians that this is a priority for us. The Conservatives don't even have a plan. The NDP want to present a false choice, and the CCF, well, we're just glad to see CCF back in the House.
Order. The Honourable Member for Vancouver Kingsway is rising on a point of order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In a moment, I'll be asking for unanimous consent for a motion. Last night, the Senate passed Bill C-45, important legislation that will positively change 100